This is Apollo Control at 48 hours into the Apollo 11 mission. The spacecraft is 160,760 nautical miles from Earth. The distance from the Moon is 64,115 nautical miles. Earth referenced velocity 3,529 feet per second. The rest period has now lasted an hour, longer than the 10-hour period scheduled. It's extended to 11 hours now. Flight surgeon says there are indications that the commander, Neil Armstrong, may be awakening, some stirring around. However, we have not yet put in a call to the crew. The mid-course correction 3 is scheduled this afternoon at an elapsed time of 53 hours 54 minutes has been canceled. The velocity value for that mid-course is only 8/10 of a foot per second, so we will not do mid-course correction number 3. We'll continue to stand by for either a call from the ground or a call from the spacecraft. Thank you. This is Apollo Control at 48 hours, 9 minutes. We've just put in a call to the crew. Here's that conversation.
Apollo 11, Apollo 11. This is Houston, over.
Good morning, Houston, Apollo 11.
Hey, good morning, Apollo 11.
Nice to meet you. Be getting around to the... How's everything left up here for your ring?
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Roger, say again, please.
Roger, how do all our systems look?
Roger, they're looking great, and as far as we can tell, they're... As far as we can tell, everything is good from down here, over.
I just like the attitude held up real well to our feet.
Yes, it did. We were showing you remaining well within a circle of 10 degrees radius throughout the night. Seems to be working beautifully.
Well, the old green team this morning. Did you have a quiet night?
Yeah, it was a very quiet night. Down here, the old black team was complaining they didn't get a chance to make any transmissions. Ron. Ron Evans is getting...
Well, we'll be seeing him tomorrow, I guess.
Yeah, Ron's getting to be known as the silent Capcom.
That's the best kind, Bruce.
Okay. A couple of small items in the way of a flight plan update and your morning consumables update. Over. Roger 11, we'd like to perform a wastewater dump at your convenience sometime in the near future here. No particular time scheduled. Down there at the time for mid-course correction 3, which is about 53:55, we're deleting mid-course correction number 3 and all the items associated with it. For your information, the calculated value of the burn for mid-course number 3 was 8/10 of a foot per second. That is 0.8 feet per second. Canceling this, if we decide to burn mid-course correction 4, this would then give you a burn for mid-course correction 4 of 2.0 feet per second. At 53 hours, we have an IMU Reliant P-52. We're requesting that you do this while in PTC, and we plan to continue PTC throughout the day. Over. Say again, please. You're cutting out.
Cancel. hours and...
11, this is Houston. Stand by a minute, please. We're having difficulty receiving you. Apollo 11, this is Houston, radio check, over.
Roger, Houston, read you loud and clear, how may I help
you? Roger, reading you the same. We did a minor reconfiguration down here. Stand by, out.
This is Apollo Control. That first conversation was with Buzz Aldrin, and Mike Collins joined in. We've not yet heard from Neil Armstrong.
Okay, 11, this is Houston. We've switched your Omni antennas as you roll through the appropriate position. Did you copy the flight plan update item? Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Apollo 11, go ahead.
Roger, 11, did you copy the flight plan update items, over.
Roger, how do you read me now, Bruce?
Loud and clear now.
Okay, the battery charge is in the process now, and the wastewater dump is... in work. MCC3 has been canceled. It would have been 0.8 feet per second. MCC4 now looks like about 2.4 feet per second. At around 53 hours, we'll do a P52 and PTC. Over.
Roger, 11. The magnitudes of the mid-course corrections were just for your information, but mid-course 4 was down around 2.0 feet per second. Again, for your information, on SPS chamber pressure, it looks like your onboard readout of 87 psi corresponds to 92 psi by our telemetry, and your value of 89 on board corresponds to 94. Over. Apollo 11, Houston, radio check on a new power amplifier in our transmitter, over.
Roger, read you loud and clear, how many, over?
Roger, loud and clear, did you copy my notes on SPS chamber pressure?
Negative.
Okay, just for your information again, it appears that your readout of 87 PSI corresponds to our corrected TM readout of 92, that's 9 or 2 PSI, and 8-9 on board is really 9-4 PSI, over. Roger, and you ready for the consumables update?
Ready to copy.
Okay, consumables update for GET of 46 plus 00 minus 5.5%, minus 6.5%, minus 2.5%, minus 7.5%, minus 5.0%, minus 2 pounds hydrogen, plus 1 pound oxygen. And that minus 5.5% on the RCS total corresponds to minus 6.6 pounds, over.
Okay, I copy those, and I'll give you our percentages now. Alpha 82, Bravo 84, Coca 85, Delta 87, over.
This is Houston. We copy your percentages, and do you have a crew status report on sleep for us?
Descending order 8, 9, and 8, over.
Houston, Roger out.
That would be Armstrong 8, Collins 9, Aldrin 8.
Houston, we're getting cryo pressure warning now in the middle of stirring up the pot.
Roger, we copy.
This is Apollo Control. The flight surgeon reports that is not a record for sleep. The Apollo 10 crew, during one rest period, logged 10 hours of sleep.
Houston, Apollo 11. That the continent of Africa race facing toward us right now, and of course everything's getting smaller and smaller. Time goes on. The Mediterranean is completely clear. The sun looks like it's about to set around Madagascar. The equatorial belt of Africa stands out quite clearly as being a dark green or muddy colored green in comparison with the sandier colors of the southern tip of Africa and, of course, the Sahara northern coast of Africa. There's a rather remarkable cloud that appears in the vicinity of the border between Afghanistan and Pakistan. It's about to go into sunset now, and it's casting quite a large shadow. Tropical convergence clouds going around the equator clearly separate the clockwise and the counterclockwise cloud formations.
Roger 11, we copy your weather description on that. I understand you can see a shadow being cast by that cloud over between Afghanistan and Pakistan. Any estimate on how long that shadow would be? Background noise now also. You stand by a minute or so until we roll a little further in CTC. I think things will get better.
Okay, it's coming around to the number one window. We'll get
Roger, we're hearing you.
That's Buzz Aldrin with the description.
Eleven, this is Houston. The noise on the comm seems to have quieted down now. I guess that we've rotated a new antenna into view and probably also the Earth out of view in your window. Over.
Okay. It looks as though the length of the shadow of that cloud is about the same as the width of the Persian Gulf.
Okay, we copy width of the Persian Gulf, and I guess that all I can give you firsthand is a single isolated data point, and that is that it was clear here in Houston this morning, but that's a pretty localized observation. As a result of your wastewater dump, it looks like the PTC mode has been disturbed somewhat. We're showing you about 20 degrees out in pitch right now and about 6 degrees in yaw, which is significantly greater, about twice as much, a little more than twice as much as the deviation you had prior to the wastewater dump. We're watching it down here, though, and we'll let you know if we think any corrective action is required. Over.
Okay, maybe we ought to next time split that in half, do half of it on one side and half on the other, something like that.
Yeah, we could do that. We were actually pretty interested in seeing what the effect on PTC would be of the wastewater dump. We don't recall ever having performed a PTC on.
Pakistan through the sextant. And it appears to be one single cell that's in the latter stage of development. There's a smaller, more isolated one just up.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. We lost you down in the noise on the comm link here about the time you were describing the single cell cloud formation over Afghanistan-Pakistan area through the sextant. Over.
Right, it came through a lot clearer through the sextant than with the monocular, and you could definitely tell it was a one single cell in the latter stages of development. It must have gone up to over 50,000 feet, though. The eastern Mediterranean is phenomenally clear. You can see all the lakes, the Dead Sea stood out quite well, Homer.
Roger, what appears to be the limit of resolution through that sextant from your current position? Over.
Well, I can't see it right now. It's outside the field of view.
Roger.
And I don't know how you'd really describe the limit of resolution. I'll think about that a little.
Okay, I guess the smallest object that you could pick out looking through it would give us a pretty good hack.
Well, you can see the Nile River going almost up to its source. The lake is obscured by clouds. You can trace it all the way on up.
Roger.
I guess that's down, isn't it?
Apollo 11, Houston.
Go ahead, Houston.
Roger, we've been working under the assumption that it would take about an hour for the interference from a wastewater dump to dissipate to the point where you could reasonably take star sightings for platform alignment, navigation, or something of this sort. If you have a spare minute or two, could you comment on the observation conditions now? Over.
Yeah, stand by one, Bruce.
Okay.
My guess would be the telescope's probably pretty useless, but you can differentiate in the sextant between water droplets and stars by the difference in their motion.
Okay, Mike, and I guess that we've still got, what you're saying is we've still got a lot of water droplets visible, but you could pick them out and distinguish in the sextant there.
Right. I think so, but Buzz is looking through it now, just a second.
Oh, okay.
radio center on 11, it looks like at this time the section would be quite usable for any alignment. There's actually very few particles cruising by.
Roger, Buzz. How about the telescope? Is it useful now?
Well, it's not quite as useful. It never seems to be dependent on the position of the sun. It's got that band that seems to go across the center. I don't think it's because of the wastewater particles that it would lack its effectiveness over.
Roger, what? Is this band something that's deposited on the outside of the optics, over?
No, it's just a reflection from the sun.
Roger.
Sun bounces off the lamp structure. With a lamp attached, that telescope is just about useless. Those star charts that MPAT provided us, I think, would be most useful if we had to use the, for some reason, we had to mark through the telescope. We could use those as a guide for what we're looking at and say, well, that bright blob over there is got to be that star because that's the position we're in. But so far, we've been, or at least I've been unable to pick out any decent star patterns while docked with the LAM using the telescope.
This is Houston. We copy.
This is Apollo Control at 49 hours, 7 minutes into the mission. Apollo 11 is 163,040 miles from Earth. Velocity 3,476 feet per second. Thank you.
Houston, Apollo 11, over.
Go ahead, Apollo 11. Apollo 11, this is Houston, go ahead. Roger, we're reading you loud and clear.
Roger, you're coming back a little scratchy. It looks like our O2 flow transducer has gotten a good bit worse. I just looked at it at the last water accumulator cycle, and it just barely registered, barely crept up above 0.3 over.
Roger. Eleven, this is Houston. At the time of your cyclic accumulator stroking, we were on low bitrate data and consequently not receiving the O2 flow parameter. We expect that what you're seeing is probably nominal. That is probably what we would expect from a transducer that's malfunctioning in this fashion. It's probably just going to keep on getting worse like that. Nothing to worry about. We'll monitor things on the ground here. Over.
Okay, it does look like it's gradually degrading to about zilch.
Roger, we copy.
This is Apollo Control at 49 hours, 52 minutes. Apollo 11's distance from Earth is 164,558 nautical miles. Its velocity is 3,441 feet per second. Thank you. This is Apollo Control at 50 hours, 16 minutes. Apollo 11 is now 165,346 nautical miles from Earth, traveling at a velocity of 3,423 feet per second. Flight controllers report all systems well within the normal range and operating very satisfactorily. Thank you.
We'll be right back.
This Apollo Control at 50 hours, 40 minutes. Apollo 11 is 166,135 miles from Earth. Capcom is going to take a radio check here, I think, with the crew.
Apollo 11 CDR, this is Houston, radio check, over.
Roger, Houston, CDR loud and clear.
Roger, we're reading you the same, huh?
And would you check with FAO and see where that errata sheet is? We haven't been able to locate that.
Roger, I understand it's supposed to be the back page in Buzz's operations checklist.
Okay.
FAO is the flight activities officer. Apollo 11's velocity is 3,404 feet per second. The spacecraft's still in the passive thermal control mode, rotating at 3/10 of a degree per second, or 3 revolutions per hour. Sporadic bursts of static that you hear on the air ground is caused by the rotation of the spacecraft, the changing the orientation of the antennas as the spacecraft slowly rotates to maintain thermal balance. The backup lunar module pilot, Fred Hayes, is at the Capcom console with Bruce McCandless. That radio check was with the Apollo 11 commander, Neil Armstrong.
Thank you.
This is Apollo Control at 50 hours, 53 minutes into the mission. An important news release will be available in the Apollo News Center at 11:45 Central Daylight Time this morning. At noon, Colonel Frank Borman will be in the Building 1 auditorium at MSC for a briefing concerning the news release. Repeating, an important news release will be available at 11:45 a.m. Central Daylight Time in the Apollo News Center at MSC. We'll be right back.